Good morning, everyone. Let us worship God. God's grace makes human faith possible. In this circle of grace and faith, miracles enter and bless our world. Please join me in our gathering words. God's voice speaks. Go where I will show you. The call and promise comes to us all. Go and I will bless you, and I will make you a blessing. Together we seek what God will show us today and commit ourselves to respond. Our opening prayer. You are a God who blesses, a God who risks being in relationship, a God who creates beginnings out of endings. Because of who you are, you call us to be who we truly are. And in your choice to pour out your grace, you push us to be a blessing beyond ourselves. Move us today, O God, to pull up the stakes, to take the first step, to go and look for what you will show us next, to be among this world as your covenant people. Amen.
Thank you.
God is faithful and asks us to be faithful as well. We seek God's way, recognizing that we are hindered by the baggage we carry along on the journey. When we confess our sin, we offer that burden to Christ and make room for the Spirit's work in our hearts, minds, and lives. Before God, with the people of God, let us confess to our brokenness. Let us pray. O Lord our God, we hear you calling, but we confess that we like the places we have come to rest. It is comfortable to stay here where we can remember those who have gone before, and we can keep things as they are. We hear you calling, but we confess that we love the altar we have built, this memorial to our encounters with you, and we are loath to leave the monument, even to follow you. We do not want to move on from here, where we have celebrated and mourned, found comfort and hope and friendship and help. We hear you calling, but we admit that we do not trust that we will encounter you out there. Forgive us for our fear and distrust, for our sense that you are the best contained in one special place. Forgive us for our instability to carry our experiences of your grace into other places and situations. Forgive us for hiding behind the buildings, institutions, and traditions we have built. Give us again the blessing of your call to go and be a blessing to others. In your name, amen.
The grace of God. It's made as well. In the grace of Christ, through the grace of the Holy Spirit, my friends, God's blessings are all around us in all the families of the earth. As human beings created in God's own image, we carry that divine blessing in our DNA. Knowing that, turn now to one another and offer these words. You are blessed by God, and you are a blessing from God. Take a moment. You are blessed by God. You are blessed by God and a blessing from God.
Glory to God, whose mighty signs on me, and to the Son, whose eyes have saddened me, and to the Spirit, whose love has set me free, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be. Is now and ever.
great. Are there any short people here today that want to come up here? Yeah, you can come. Hey, friend. There you go. So what did you guys learn about in Sunday school today? What was the guy's name again? He looked like Santa Claus. Can you remember? Starts with an A. How's Abram sound? Sounds about right? Okay. Yeah? Does it sound right? Good. So I've got my story straight about Abram. So he was an old dude. He was like 75 years old. Wow. Got y'all. I think they get a little mad at me for saying that. That's okay. They'll forgive me later. So God talked to Abram, and God said to Abram, I want you to pack up everything you have and take it and move away from where you are. But I can't tell you where you go yet. You just got to trust me. Now, will you pack up everything you have, all your clothes and all your toys and everything, and just hit the road without knowing where you're going? Like at least knowing that you're going to grandma's house or your cousin's or something? Would you? If you had to. Yeah, it would be a strong had to, right? That's kind of... It's scary to think, right? To just go on the road and you don't know where you're going, but you got to just start walking. All right. So this is how scary. Do you think either one of you can make it back to your mom's if you couldn't see where they're sitting? If you had a blindfold on, do you think you can make it back there? Let me ask you this. Can I put a blindfold on you? Come here. Let's put a blindfold on you for a second. Would you mind? Okay. Stand up for me a sec. All right. I'm going to close your eyes up. All right. Good. I don't want you to see anything. Can you make it to your mom now? All right. Hold on that on. If Miss Debbie was to hold your hand, right, and walk you to your mom with the blindfold on, would you trust that she would take you there without you falling or bumping into anything? You know Miss Debbie, right? All right. I'm going to let Miss Debbie come and walk you to your mom. Now, see if you hold her hand and you keep it like that, if you can make it back to your mom. There you go. Let's see. If she bumps you into something, I'm really sorry, Tegan. You said you trusted her. Was that a little less scary? Huh? Was that a little scary? Was it okay? But Tegan, because Miss Debbie hold your hand, did that make it better? All right. So that's kind of what Abram promised, or God promised to Abram. He said, even if you can't see where you're going right now, I am walking all the way with you, and I will hold your hand. So if we trust God, even when things are scary and we don't know quite where we're going or what's going to happen, we can trust that God will get us there safely, just like Miss Debbie when she held your hand and you couldn't see where you were going. How's that sound? Yeah. Can we pray? Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Hello, God. Thank you that we can know even when things are scary for us and we don't quite know what's going to happen, that you always hold our hand and that you guide us where we need to go so we don't have to be afraid. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Let us pray for God's wisdom and guidance. Still speaking, God, we come here wanting to connect with you and our neighbors. Open our hearts to hear the truth in your words of people of faith through the ages. Then give us courage to share what we have heard. Amen. Our first reading is from Matthew 28, verses 19 through 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Look, I myself will be with you every day until the end of this present age.
All we need to run.
So our reading today that follows the narrative lectionary, so it's the second reading for this year, as we move through the Old Testament, comes from Genesis chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 through 9. Let us listen to the word of God for us today. The Lord said to Abram, "Leave your land, your family, and your father's household for the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation and will bless you. I will make your name respected and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and those who curse you, I will curse. And all the families of the earth will be blessed because of you." And Abram left, just as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Now, Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. Now, Abram took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all of their possessions, and those who became members of their household in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan. And when they arrived in Canaan, Abram traveled through the land as far as the sacred place at Shechem, at the Oak of Moreh. And the Canaanites lived in the land at that time. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "I give this land to your descendants." So Abram built an altar there to the Lord who appeared to him. And from there he traveled toward the mountains east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And then he built an altar to the Lord and worshiped in the Lord's name. And then Abram set out towards the arid southern plain, making and breaking camp as he went. This is the word of the Lord. So Wednesday, we had a missionary partner here in the afternoon, Mr. Maniatalia, who is from Tuvalu. And he had an eye-opening and really heart-wrenching presentation on the effects of climate change and global warming on his home country. Tuvalu consists of 9 little islands, and at most is about 4 to 5 meters above sea level. But due to global warming and the rise of the waters, Tuvalu has been flooding severely over the last several years. And after the last typhoon, the water just really ran right across and buried the island for a while. And at this point in time, every time king tide comes around, once a month high tide, the same thing happens. Water plainly run from one end straight over to the other end of the island, and people have to scramble to get the stuff that they would like to keep dry to the highest places possible. And in this mess, try to make a life for themselves. And for a while, I sat with what he told us on Wednesday and how it ties in to the passage of today of being blessed to be a blessing. And really, what a poor job that we who are blessed have done to be a blessing for others in the world that has not been as lucky as we have. How we used our technology and our gifts and our talents to take care of ourselves, to bring comfort, while those who are not developed are paying the price for us to sit in our comfort. We have used our blessings while others are suffering because of climate change. We have hoarded more and more for ourselves while others have to fend for themselves. And in the process, left whole nations like the nation of Tuvalu to think about where they might need to move to as a people if they want to survive, to leave their homes behind. Now, Mr. Talia also talked briefly about colonization, which happened for them sort of roughly in 1865 when missionaries came. And the whole island are now Christian. They are a Christian nation. But he also talked about how they were taught to read the Bible have made them more individualistic instead of community-oriented, and how they live with one another, how fear has started to creep in. And that made me think, too, how ones who were supposed to be a blessing have not done so well. I come from a country where Europeans came and took land from black and brown bodies, oppressed them, took every opportunity from them in the name of Christianizing. And the same happened in this country. Native people were banned from their lands. Their language was taken from them. They were put in boarding schools to take the Indian out of them. How much have we lost in this world because of what we have taken in the name of Christianity from other peoples? And I couldn't help but think that this was really not quite what God had in mind when he told Abram to pick up and go and to be a blessing. See, in our story today, I think the intent of the voice that spoke was the wholeness and the shalom for all the people of the earth. That same voice that called creation into being is now offering a second call to Abram. A call to use Abram to fashion an alternative community in creation in which the people created in God's image and made a lot of really terrible choices and lived in a world of violence. And I think what God was trying to do was to empower or to embody, really, through Abram, blessings on the nations whose story started all the way back in the Garden of Eden. And through bad choices, those were moved out. And through more bad choices, Noah and the flood happened. Noah sailed away, and more bad choices to the Tower of Babel, which God had to break down and disperse people. And once again, God remembers God's promises, and he calls on Abram to go and determine the future of history from here on out. And God calls on Abram to pack up. The Hebrew really says, pack yourself up and go. To get himself up and go away from his country, his land, his family, to a place that God will show him, maybe at some point. It feels to me like that is not a heck of a lot to go on. And that is maybe one of the most annoying things about God. For those of you that have experienced this kind of thing, which I'm sure is all of you, God calls us to things and to places and to actions, but it always feels like he's a little short on the details of the call. But God doesn't just leave it there. God continues to bless Abram. He sends him with blessings towards a new land where his offspring will be as many as the stars in the sky, where he will have a strong reputation, where he will be blessed to be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. There's one problem here, folks. In the two or three verses right before I started reading, we learned that Sarah is barren. Now, if Abram was promised descendants as many as the sky, and his wife is barren, it seems to me that except for being short on details, God is also calling Abram to the impossible. How is this going to work? And that, my friends, is still how God works today. God is still calling all of us on unknown journeys to unknown futures, asking us to believe the impossible. The impossible that broken people can be restored, that the lame will walk again, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, that the year of Jubilee will come, that there will be peace on earth. And how the heck do you believe that? If we look around us to the world that we live in now, it really seems like God is calling us to the impossible. But this call is so much more than a call to the impossible. See, the beauty here is that it is also a call to newness. A place where Abram has really never been before. And that signifies to me that this might be an invitation for Abram to live into hope. To wait for the fulfillment and to trust that the one who spoke these promises will also be the keeper of these promises. It is trust for Abram that even when things seems impossible, and to us too sometimes, that the promises are kept by God's power and not by ours. It is an invitation for all of us to have faith when there is no evidence yet. Blessing and well-being in a world full of curse and violence. It is a call to believe in the promise of shalom, of healing and wholeness for all of God's people. And so then Abram picks up and he goes. Now, there is room for discussion here in why he did that. Because we don't know that Abram knew God before this little call happened. His father was polytheistic, believed in more than one God. I don't know. Maybe he was just a trusting guy. Maybe he longed for peace, for this blessing of all people so much that he couldn't help but believe in the mission that God was sending him on. And I'm quite sure that what God promised him might just helped a wee bit to get him moving. But I wonder, would you go? If you were Abram right now, if God called you to leave behind everything you know, your safety, your security, everything that you worked for all your life, without knowing where you're going, Would you pack up right now? Would you, like Abram, dare to become a hoper who trusts the speaker to keep the speaker's promises? Would you start this new and daring and dangerous journey away from old securities and gifts into a new and treacherous world of wonderful blessings? Even if you couldn't imagine what it looked like yet? And what would you have to hear from God in order for you to even start contemplating this? What would that sound like? No one? Anyone? Would you go? If it wasn't a literal question of leaving and going, but to disconnect from traditions and the way we have always done it, to open up to new experiences in worship or in the ways we serve, does that sound different? And then, would you do it? Remember that Abram was not a poor man. When God told him to pack up everything he had in Haran, we know that he had livestock that he had to get together. He had a wife. He had his nephew, whose father, Haran, has died. And a bunch of people that he acquired into his household already. Abram lived lives much like ours, full of things and possessions, comfort and security. To become a refugee. But I wonder, I cannot help but wonder if this promise of a great nation away from the barrenness that he experienced is what drove Abram to go. As God calls this hopeless one into a community with a future. Because, see, I think the only way out of barrenness sometimes, away from what keeps us dead, into blessing, is to depart from the securities that we hold right now and risk to take the next step into a new place of being. Because sometimes I think to remain in safety is also to remain barren. I think sometimes to leave in the risk to have hope moves us from that barrenness. After all, Jesus says in Mark, all who want to save their lives will lose them. But all who lose their lives because of me and because of the good news will save them. And so Abram picks up and becomes a sojourner on a pilgrimage, blessed to be a blessing, choosing to trust the one who made the promises. Not solely to be blessed so that everyone will have him, or so that he would not have any issues or pain or grief or concerns in his life. But to become a blessing and definitely not a colonizer. We never read that Abram had any problems with the people into which land he moved. He went to live in a land that was already occupied by the Canaanites. He lived to be in a country where the promise was at risk, where their ways of doing was more effective and their practices definitely more attractive than the slow and unfolding promises of God. You see, it's never easy to believe or practice God's promise because we have to give up a lot to live against a culture that speaks against our own, or for our own safety and comfort. How often do we hear that brown and black people, especially those who come across the border, will change our culture and who we are and our being as a nation, and they will all take our jobs? How often do we hear that brown and black bodies are a threat? How often, my friends, do we hear that guns are what is going to keep us safe, and so also our possessions and all our stuff and what is ours? We live in a culture that cares more about material stuff and prosperity than the well-being of all people. That is exactly what God calls us to do. To live in a world that is countercultural than that what God has promised us. Not to colonize or to take over, but to live in a way with the blessings of God that will share them for a world to see, so that others might be blessed too. We are called to that. So my question is, are we willing to risk it? Are we willing to trust in God's promises that this church, that the church universal, is the body of Christ in this world, and that when God's will is done, this church will move forward and even thrive, even if it doesn't look like it did 100 years ago? Are we willing to step into a place and risk everything where all people around us will be welcome at the table and be blessed by how we feed them? See, God is always on the move, always doing a new thing, always sojourning on a pilgrimage, going out in front of us. Are we willing to step out behind God and follow, finding new ways and new beginnings to live into God's promises, who was willing to be vulnerable enough to show the fulfillment of his promises in the vulnerability of death on a cross? We are all called to follow. God is calling all of us, just like God called Abram to be on a pilgrimage and to just plainly trust that God will take us to the place that God will point out to us, to the place that we are to inhabit of how we need to be in this world. And I can promise you, with certainty, it's not going to be comfortable. And I can put money on that it's not going to be easy. Because we're going to have to change the way we do things from the way we always have. We're going to have to change the way we share. We are going to have to change the way we risk things and do stuff we've never done before. It might just mean risking everything to go on pilgrimage and trust that God is with us, with blessings and new beginnings that we cannot even begin to comprehend right now. So what do you say? Are you in? Are you in for a ride that might not look like anything you've done before, but that ends up with blessings that we cannot imagine? So take a risk, my friends, because it will be beautiful, and live into the hope of God's promises. May it be so. For all the ways that you have blessed us, for the ways in which you work among and in us and through us. All at the same time, you pour out your blessings and you invite us to join you on a journey, to turn our eyes forward and to risk following where it is that you lead us. We pause today to lift up those among us who feel stuck where they are. Ourselves, our friends and neighbors, people we have not met, but whose lives are entwined with ours in your great human family. All of us who cannot imagine another way. or those who are trapped in grief or despair or illness or violence or cycles of poverty, who both long for newness and are afraid to try again. May they know themselves guided by your strong and supportive hand. We hold before you in stillness the millions who are suffering from floods and hurricanes and typhoons and wildfires and droughts, all because of climate change. We pray especially for the people of Japan and Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, Nigeria and Pakistan, and now also adding our neighbors in Canada. Give strength. Help us provide urgently required supplies and food and shelter for all who was made homeless or ill by polluted floodwaters. We bring to you all those nations who suffer and are losing their ways of life because of climate change and global warming. And especially today, we lift up the people of Tuvalu as we have heard their story this week. Help us to be those who do not think just about our own comfort and ways of gain, but rather about how we live with and among all your children as our neighbors. Please help and encourage us to be good stewards of your earth and to be a blessing to your creation and your children. We also remember all those struggling to survive and longing for peace and being with loved ones again. In particular, we remember the horrors being uncovered in the freed areas of Ukraine. As we also pray for those who are trying to find refuge within the borders of this country and find themselves being used as pawns. Hear us and help us to make peace and justice our task. We pray, O God, for all those who are suffering in mind and body and spirit, especially that we hold dear to our hearts in this community. Bring peace, bring healing, bring comfort in times of grief. And also calm anxious minds awaiting results. And help us once again to be the blessing that support them in their processes of healing or grief. And as we respond to your blessing, O God, we commit ourselves in your name to put out a hand to help those for whom the risks feel bigger than the possibilities. To those who have been held back rather than helped along. To those who no longer have the confidence or ability to trust themselves, let alone you or others. May all of your children experience your presence through our love as their neighbors. We pray these things and all things in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, there's going to be some kids coming around too during the offering. And they, if you've written anything on your little card, they will have a separate plate. So put it in the little ones' plates for me, please. They will come around and pick that up.
Will the ushers and children please come forward? Through this invitation to share our gifts, we acknowledge that God has blessed us abundantly and that we are to be a blessing to the world. In the very act of giving, in every act of bestowing blessings on another, we find that we are blessed yet again. I encourage you now to enter fully into this amazing cycle of blessing. Very appropriate. A prayer of dedication. Calling God, you invite us into a future filled with possibilities and promises. We give you thanks for the blessings you have given to us so that all people might be blessed through us. Through what we offer for your service today, magnify your love and make your glory known. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
My friends, go forth as yourself, the one who God calls. Go to yourself to know the love of the Holy Spirit that is poured into your heart just as you are. And then go be yourself, blessed to be a blessing to others in Christ's name. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you all his everlasting peace. Amen.